Welcome to A Gentleman's Guide. Tom Van.
Dan Dennis.
Steve Kramer.
Steve Kramer Skyping in. Hey, you look good, dude. Your hair is very long. You're very long, almost. It's getting into surfer dude range. You're getting into surfer dude range.
It is definitely in that range.
Steve, where are you at? Are you at your office? Are you home?
No, my office has been, I'm working remotely, so I'm at home. I'm not in my office because that is the classroom for homeschooling. So I'm in my gentleman's room.
How is first things first? How is homeschooling going? Is everybody safe and okay? And you know, I guess as good as they can be.
Yeah, I think that's about right. I mean, I think everybody's as good as they can be. We're just like everybody else and trying to get through.
There should be an easier way. I know that they're trying to figure it out. But my Crystal told me that she's like, there's an assignment from each one of Tommy's like regular teacher. Then there's the art teacher. Then there's the PE. Then there's the music. And they're all trying to like, well, here's an assignment and stuff. But then she's like, there's too much, you know, especially a kindergartner. They're like,
well, it's kind of hard to gauge. And at school, it's so, to me, at school, it's so focused that at home, it's going to be impossible to keep the focus level of a separate building, a comfortable classroom, a teacher that, you know, commands a certain level of attention. You know, mommy commands a certain level of attention as well, but mommy's also the mommy. That's going
to
pull.
They don't listen to mommy as well and dad as well as they do strangers school because they know what they can get away with us.
When you're in your comfort zone, man, I mean, you hurt your family the most because you know they're going to take you back. Yeah. I mean, that's just what you do.
Also, I assume that most days, Tommy's normal teacher doesn't have the severe wine flu like his current teacher does, which hinders her ability to teach because she's feeling it.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, bad, bad.
Yeah, when you're hungover, it's extremely hard to surf Pinterest while your kids do a myriad of assignments.
Wine teaching.
What?
Oh, he asked if she's wine teaching.
Oh, well, I mean, she's doing the thing. I just said, it's all good.
Well, the thing she's fucking up is maybe it would be smart to feed Tommy and Max wine as well. Get them on the same level, right? And then if they're on the same level, then maybe the teaching go a little bit better. Or maybe they just go hang in the pool.
That's what I said. I'm like, it's
Jesus juice. Isn't that what
Michael Jackson did? Let me ask you a serious question that I've been wondering multiple times, not to bring the show down or get the show serious at all, but is this a good time, in your opinion, Steve, as an attorney, is this a good time to be a pedophile or a bad time to be a pedophile?
It is never a good time to do that. That's a really
if you had to pick a season or a time, is spring pedophile time or is fall? Like right now in a corona lockdown, I feel like there are no victims running around, and I feel like you're
hard times.
Yeah, it's hard times for pedophiles.
Slim picking.
Yeah. Kids are safe right now, and kids are safe. So there's a silver lining to what's going on. If kids are safe, that's a silver lining.
But I mean, like now, if you were a pedophile, now I'm being serious. Since kids are inside, you can go out now and live your life.
Well, if you got kids inside your house, then it's
well, you can't get them out. They're dead. They're as good as dead. They have to stay inside now.
Anyway,
especially if they're infected. Oh my God, what would they do if you?
You know, I thought we got coronavirus. We can't go darker, but we've gone darker.
We always go darker. That's what my wife says when I'm videotaping her and the big black bull who's pump fucking her hard. I ask her, I go, "You want to go darker?" She goes, "Yeah, bigger and darker." I got him to laugh. I saw it.
Steve's I didn't even want to do this.
Steve's like, "This is stupid. I'm freaking out. I'm in my house. I'm wearing a CBGB shirt. I've got long surfer hair, and you fools call me up to talk about when's a good time to be a pedophile."
So, Steve, you're working remotely, and I did think about this the other day with everybody's talking about the baby boom. 9 months from now. But I'm more thinking about the divorce boom, like one month from now, because it seems like
you mentioned this yesterday.
People are at each other's throats.
Well, as a question for Steve, I mean, you're literally watching a gold mine form in front of your eyes, right?
They call it deferred interest in those legal services because, you know, not many people are acting on that right now because everybody's in lockdown. But, you know, normally people have like a little bit of space. I mean, they have some personal space. They can go to work. They can get away. You know, you're forcing people together at all times, and they're at each other's throats. They're driving each other nuts. They can't get away. They can't escape. And you can bet it's going to test a lot of relationships.
Yeah. Yeah. 100%. Then you add the added stress of everything and financially and your own health and then everything you can't get away from it. Man, it's putting some pressure on I'm guessing a lot of our relationships.
Well, I mean, like you and I've talked about it. I mean, Steven, I don't know if you have been, you know, I don't know much about your relationship. You're a pretty guarded guy, but have you and your wife had a little more going at it a little bit more, not in the fun way, but in like the getting on each other's nerves way?
You know, we got a really good relationship and we're best friends, and I think one of the reasons we wound up together was because I was the first guy that didn't drive her crazy. You know what I mean? So I think we're homebodies to a certain extent too. So, I mean, that makes it easier, but certainly I think everybody in America's stress level is higher than normal right now. And when you add all those factors that Tom mentioned in, that makes it a lot more likely that some relationships they're going to be tested and not all are going to make it because, I mean, just the financial alone, just if you took the financial component of this, you would see a rise in relationships falling apart and divorce because financial is one of the biggest predictors of divorce, right? And, you know, add financial, you know, just generalized stress, you know, kids around at all times and no break from that, no break from your spouse, really, no freedom or independent time, no way to, you know, a loss of options to blow off steam. I mean, all those add up to possibly more relationships ending. Yeah.
It also seems that any opinion, man, for me, it's just better to not have an opinion on anything because anytime you take an opinion, it seems like you're leaning one side or the other or towards one side of the argument or the other. And that causes arguments. For instance, this happened to me and my wife last night where I just made a slight opinion to,
I don't like your pubes shaved that way.
People, I'm like, man, it seems like, you know, everybody obviously be responsible and follow science and what doctors say, but, seem like people are, you know, overreacting and freaking out more than they should be based upon their consumption of all media altogether, bombarding them with stress, causing their anxiety level to go up, causing them to act irrationally, and people should just take a break from all media.
Well, it's just like food. You're putting garbage in your brain, and you're going to have to poop that out, and it's probably going to come out in anger towards your significant other.
Yeah. And
well,
it's
part of a fear cycle. You know, people are afraid. They're trying to feed that anxiety, control it. And, you know, one of the ways they're doing that is by taking in more information, but instead of reducing their anxiety, it amplifies it. And you wind up in like an anxiety news feedback loop. And yeah, I think you got to take a break from that and try to enjoy some other aspects of your life.
Yeah. And that's the biggest thing, too, because then you're like, all right, this is going to be, we're in it for the long haul. Like, you know, let's just say even 30 days from now, obviously it's not going to be over. But if we're all just looking and taking it day by day and just looking at the calendar and be like, all right, got to get through these next 30 days. It definitely doesn't do you any good just consuming endless, you know, social media and endless news cycle stories and all this, like, just every day. You're not learning anything different. It's like, all right, to do what they say to do, and then, you know, try to have the, you know, the most normal life you can, and, you know, the most healthy life you can. And but it seems like you always fall back to, all right, let's see what's on social media. What is this story? This story, this story. Scroll. You
know, I mean, the way I'm doing it is like setting, I don't know if it works for everybody, but setting some boundaries. You know, there are certain times when I'm going to watch the news because I want to know what's going on. I want to see what's happening today. And then there are other times where I'm not going to. And then, I mean, the gym too, that's another one. That's another tool that people have lost right now, is they can't go to the gym. So, you know, I mean, that's another stress reliever. That's a healthy one. You know, people are turning to other options to reduce stress that aren't as healthy. Like, I mean, I'm sure alcohol consumption is probably way up right now. You know, might be fun for a night, but on the whole, that's not going to fix the situation.
Well, you got to keep doing it.
Yeah, you can't stop.
Yeah. Let me stop you right there.
See,
Steve,
when you stop, that's when it becomes bad.
Exactly. Yeah. Tom knows. You just got to keep doing it, and then you're going to crave more and more and more. And you know what? Feed into that and keep going more and more and more, and push yourself to a limit. It's just like being in the gym. You know, you don't think you can do 12 beers? Try it. Yeah. Push yourself a little.
It's the last couple beers that make the difference.
Exactly.
That's when you
got to gas out. Everybody knows that in order to build muscle, you have to destroy, got to tear down the fibers.
It's the last 2.5 beers that really.
Happens when you wake up with a constant hangover?
Oh, you got to drink again. I just told you this, Steve. We were through this. And if you really want to maximize your leg muscles, you got to kick the dog.
It is possible, but
you got to kick him hard. You got to kick him right in his kidneys.
The last hangover I had convinced me not to drink forever.
That's what I said, Steven, this morning.
Steven, come over here right now and fucking drink with us. And we're going to get so – we're going to drink.
I should show you the bottle of bourbon that Jimmy got me.
We're going to drink. Don't drink it. Jimmy puts – Jimmy likes to jack off at all his bourbon.
You didn't know that?
It has a wax seal on it. Hold on.
He's going to get it.
I know what that wax seal is.
It's not wax. It's the same shit that's on my Peloton riding shorts.
If it looks like a Gandalf sneezed on the top of it, you'll know.
All right. Ooh. So, this was Jimmy got me this bottle.
Okay.
This is Booker's.
Oh,
from
1981.
Look at the color of that bourbon.
Wow.
That's beautiful, right?
That looks just like my alcoholic doo-doos. It looks just like a diarrhea.
It looks like my pee. My pee-pee
looks like Coca-Cola.
This is not like the best bottle of scotch in the world, okay?
What?
Your screen froze for a second. I'm like, there he goes. He's done. He's drunk.
Steve, how much?
Check that out.
Wow, that's nice, man. Hold on. Let me zoom in. I'm zooming in on that a little bit.
See this? This is a tax stamp that they used to have to put on liquor bottles in Florida, right? They used to have a put tax stamp on them. And what you can do is you can pull the tax stamp information and date the bottle. And this bottle of scotch is from 1965.
Whoa, dude. Where'd you get that? Or you just been holding on to that for a rainy day?
I bought it somewhere for $3.
Oh, my God.
I know. So it's 87-year-old scotch. I've not opened it yet.
I wonder what that even would taste like. Because now, I know with beer, you want as fresh as humanly possible. With wines and liquors and spirits, I don't really know.
They age, they get better.
Is it an acquired thing, or can it get to a point where you're like, sorry, you can't go anymore, or?
Like, yeah, is there a finite? I think it, there's definitely, you know.
There's like Madeiras and ports that are, you know, hundreds of years old that are delicious. You know, with wine, it can turn to vinegar if it's not stored properly. And then it can get solids in it at the bottom of the bottle. That's why you have only it has a candle, and you know they have a particular way of pouring the wine. With bourbon and scotch, I don't think there's any limit on the age, as far as I know. But I'm not like an expert on it.
Steve, do you have a traditional bar at your house? Because going into the gentleman theme, I've always.
I don't have a lot of time in your home right now. Yeah. So a lot of gentlemen, Tom and myself included, I'm sure you are too, Steve. We're doing a lot of like gentlemanly handiwork and handyman type stuff that we might have neglected, you know, because of jobs and life and family and everything else.
But I've always wanted a proper bar just with like the staples on it, even though. Rarely do people come to the house and ask for hard liquor or whatever. It's just not a thing.
You have a bar.
No, that's what it used to be. I mean, when I remember with my grandfather, anytime somebody came over, he'd offer them a drink. And, you know, of course, he was willing to give them, you know, 7-Up or Coke or water or whatever. But what he meant also was, do you want like me to make you something at the bar? So, I mean, I think that there was a lot of that tradition, you know, in the past.
Do you have the bar displayed, like set up as a miniature, like version of a proper bar? Like, should you have a tiny little area with bottles and glasses? And I mean, I guess you're not going to keep ice.
My house, I have like a bar that's built in it. So it's actually like a bar. So there's no question what the purpose is for. It's not like a little bitty kitchen with a mini fridge and a wine rack. It's a bar. But for like your house, I would think the way you would do it is do an outdoor bar. You built your pool. You've got your pool deck now. You've done all that work. That would be a good option.
Yeah, you're not indoor bar material.
This guy's clowning me.
Are you clowning me?
For your type of house,
outdoor bar. You get a couple of apple crates and put some moonshine on it. And then
Washburn Imports and go talk to them and get one of those cool bars that they bring over from India or Bali or wherever, or Myanmar or whatever it is that they're bringing it from. You know, they bring those containers over of cool stuff, and you can just put it out there. It doesn't have to be, you know, built up. It could be like a piece of furniture outdoor bar, like a teak bar that's, you know, you're not using it all the time. You're using it when you have company over.
You know the one at Costco with all the palm fronds on top that had the light up Corona sign? And like, that's what you need for your style.
Like a tiki hut.
Yeah, yeah.
You need
the that's like a
castle bar style.
You know, you've got your foosball table, your, you know, old living room sofa that you moved to the basement, and your bar down there.
You just need like a rolly cooler and like, and just like one of those tents that fat people set up at the beach.
So, but
the bar's wherever I'm at, bud.
What staples should you have at a gentleman's bar? Whiskey, bourbon.
Well, are we talking a Winter Park bar? Or are we talking a Castleberry bar?
I think we should delineate.
I'll give you mine.
Okay. And then Tom will give you his.
I bartended all through law school, and so I have a properly stocked bar. You know, I've got all of the clear liquors. I've got, I've got the bourbon, the scotch, and a variety of those. And then I've got, bitters and wines, white and reds, a few different types and varieties of those. And always keep some chilled champagne. And then you've got your jigger. You've got your mixer, shaker. You've got your shaker. You've got your strainer, so if you want to mix a drink, you can pour your drink, and then any other accoutrement you need. You know, I mean, glasses. You gotta have a pint glass for your beers. You gotta have wine glasses for your wine. You gotta have martini glasses for your martinis. Rocks glasses for your old fashions or scotch or whatever. I mean, and you just make sure you have your tools, your serving ware, I guess glassware. And then your liquors.
Well, the first thing I see, I'm looking at a picture of Tom's bar, and the first thing you'll see is that he starts off with an array of sour apple and grape pucker. These are shots that he likes to do with some of the younger girls that are in the neighborhood. Then we'll move on to warm tequila beer. And or land shark, and then he finishes with a very, very, very fancy bottle of just traditional Captain Morgan.
Who wants a mum?
I'll show you what I got up here. I'll do the walking tour.
Oh, right? Yeah. Hey, is your piano near you?
My piano is downstairs.
Oh, is that? Are the kids? Yeah. Or can you play us a song? Can you play My Corona?
So this is we play poker in this room. When I do poker nights, and then the guys that I play poker with mainly drink bourbon and scotch. So I've got.
Hey Tom,
you know, I've got,
you've never been invited to see.
Hold on, when do you have a poker night? I know. Yeah, right. I've never been invited.
Yeah, we're the boys. You've never invited us to poker night.
I ever go.
Is this because we threw
away poker?
Is this because we threw away the cowboy boys' hats?
I want to go. Just straight up take advantage of all your rich friends that probably. I mean, what are we talking here? You know, dabble in some online poker and
what are the
gym rummy?
No. I mean, I haven't done one in a while. It's not a big one. Usually it's five or six guys are all. When I do it, it's guys that I went to high school and college with that they're all attorneys, which is weird. But yeah, they drink bourbon.
He threw that in there to let you know you can't. He threw that in there to let you know that academically you are not in the same playing field.
Yeah, I'd be like Zach Galifianakis. So,
Steven,
up.
I like you on Skype because you're really fucking getting Tom good, and I love it. Get him good,
Steve. I think
Steve.
It's a distance. You're bullying me.
It's been a month since Steven has really bullied you. And
my poker game, all my friends are attorney. Weird. That's weird.
It's weird having this much knowledge in one room.
No, it's just weird that they some of my close friends wound up being in the same career. That's what's weird. Not that they were successful or whatever, so this is my like bar cart, and I keep, you know, rocks glasses here, and then a couple of bourbons and scotches. You know, I got a new bottle of Blanton's my buddy got me.
Blands is legit.
Great.
Steve, what did you
I'm a fan.
In the decorative, because at the fancy bars, I always see like people take the liquor out of the bottle they bought it in, and then they pour it in that weird crystallized.
Like a decanter.
Is it a decanter?
Yeah, that's a decanter.
So is that for presentation, or what is that for?
I mean, yeah, of course it's for presentation. A
you
nice
idiot. You fucking idiot.
That's only an outdoor bar.
Did you hear the pause? Only a fucking outdoor bar idiot. Oh, what is it for? Oh, it's to stick up your ass.
I don't know.
It's to stick in your ass, you dumb shit. Of course it is. Steven, get him so... Oh, Steven, you're getting him so good. I'm so happy right now. Oh, what a fucking Wednesday. I needed this. I've had so much stress. It's fucking Corona. And then Steven comes in. He's like, the pause and the look at his face when you said, what's a decanter? What's that fighting thing for? Jesus Christ.
I don't know what the shit that is.
You know what? What do you mean?
I don't. I don't know what
it is. It's aesthetics. It's crystal. It's like, it could be Waterford. It could be.
Yeah, but if you have a fancy whiskey, don't you want to show people that it's a fancy whiskey? Not it's in poured into the fucking generalized crystal thing.
You would either tell them that or let them taste it and go like, wow, this is really good. And you go, oh, that's a bottle of Pappy.
Yeah.
Or like Sam, you know, Sam. He is a connoisseur of bourbon and whiskey, and he has a decanter, and he keeps like a mix of – he has like his own house mix. So, you know, if he gets a Stag whiskey and Weller whiskey and Eagle Rare and Buffalo Trace or Van Winkle or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, maybe not Van Winkle, but if he gets those other ones, the remnants, he'll like pour into his decanter, I think, and he has like a house mix of all of these different whiskeys that he mixes together. So that's another option too.
So he's kind of made his own blend. That's pretty cool. Yeah. I've never even heard of that.
Another thing that's kind of a trick that that I was taught a long time ago is you should have like your own house wine.
What do you mean?
Well, Tom has that. His whole house is made of wine. It's wine bottles.
Like, so like a wine that you have that is one that you kind of keep around that you know, if you got guests over, it's kind of you can offer it to them. It's one that you is tried and true. You love it. It's one that you if you want any time for whatever, you know, you've got it available. And it doesn't have to be expensive or anything. You know, I mean, like we the one that we use is a Beaujolais, and it's not it was like, I don't know. Inexpensive wine is an inexpensive wine, but a good wine.
Tom you use Beaujolais. Tom uses Frito-Lay.
I like a Beaujolais. You ever heard of that? French, I think.
It's like Beaujolais. I mean, nothing crazy. It's just kind of a something good to have around.
Steve, let's take a tour of your house.
Yeah, tour.
Walk out to your jet skis. You took out
those.
That's where you want
to
go.
Will your internet go to your jet skis? Hey, get on the jet ski with your laptop and spray your neighbors.
Do the Tiger King Dutch boy.
Oh, my God. That show is amazing.
It's pretty fucking good, man.
Will you ride your jet ski?
I watched the first episode last night because I had no idea how nuts it was going to get, and I don't feel like I got a chance to fully appreciate the good times before everything went to shit.
Steven, we are going to talk to a lady that worked with Carol Baskins, who arguably has become the villain in this thing, which is weird because they're all villains. They're all like crazy villains.
Yeah.
They're all like not sane.
They all
have like sprinklings of being a bad person. Yeah. You know, they all do like kind of bad
things.
Yeah, they're just not good. They're not the type of people that my mom growing up would have said I needed to hang out with. And so we're going to talk to somebody on the Friday Free Show about that. But I'm glad you're into this, man, because it's going to get – if you just did first episode, dude, you have so –
No, I watched the whole thing. Then I went back and watched the first episode.
Oh, I'm going to have to do that then so I can be able to –
Because I wanted to go back to the good times.
Yeah, because it falls apart fast.
Yeah.
It really does. I mean, and the weird thing is I feel like from my career I've met all of those people.
I was going to ask you.
Oh, I bet you have.
Steve,
yeah.
I mean, you've been an attorney in Florida for a long time. Have you ever dealt with an exotic animal case?
Yes.
Big cat people.
Oh, and what was it like?
I didn't deal with anybody that was dealing with them, but I've dealt with animal cases and endangered animal cases. And I didn't deal with animal cases in every which way. I mean, in your own neighborhood, I had a case with your neighborhood that dealt with animals in the neighborhood.
He's just getting you so bad.
We had the raccoon king of Casabarra County.
I remember the case. It was 06, I believe. I just, you know, my firm was growing, and I was dealing with the raccoon king of Casabarra, I was fucking his ass good.
Oh, yeah.
That's the funny part. It was actually your neighborhood, Daniel.
Oh, he's in Baldwin.
Yeah.
Must have been one of those money badgers. The money badgers are crazy.
Those are the archetypes of those people, but I've definitely met, you know, people that have a similar vibe. I mean, I can't even count how many con men I've met in my career. You know, I can spot them a mile away. The worst person in that show is Jeff, the guy that with the hat that comes in and loves to have the orgies and came in to help out Joe, that guy.
Where the meme is like a picture of him and says, this is what gas station boner pills look like if they were a person or whatever.
That guy's the worst.
You're all right. I've talked to Daniel about this on the last Friday show. I'm like, I know people like that guy, and it's a breed of human being.
Yeah,
and it's bizarre. It's like they're all the same. Like you're seeing that guy, you're like, holy shit, this guy is like this guy. No, they don't know each other, but it's like whatever that personality type, that breed of con men or whatever, the way you live your life, there are plenty of that type of person.
You know who it reminds me of?
The crazy thing about them is sometimes that guy is riding high and he's found some niche business. You know, maybe it's in the 90s, it was like check cashing places or massage places. You know, he's found that niche business and sometimes he's riding the crest of that wave high and other times he's low. But, you know, I've met that guy 1,000 times.
You bring up an interesting point, Steve, because I've often had this theory that there's a lot of businesses that, like, legitimate businessmen don't want to be in, so they shy away from. But there's money to be made. There's plenty of money to be made in some of these sketchier businesses. And it takes someone.
Some of them aren't even sketchy. Like, you know, they're like tanning places. I mean, that you don't think of that as a sketchy business. I mean, mortgage brokers, you don't think that necessarily is being sketchy. I mean, there's all kinds of businesses So you could have legitimate businesses that have sketchy people. That's the other part of it, you know?
Yeah, well, that's what I mean. Like, I'm talking about the pawn shops of the world and the bail bondsmen's of the world and the strip clubs of the world.
There are people that do those.
Legitimately, you know, I know.
But would you say that probably the vast...
You almost have to... Like, it's better for you if you're a bail bondsman, if you're a straight-laced, straight-shooter kind of guy. So, I mean, I've met a lot of bail bondsmen, and... They don't typically. They're not that guy.
You know? Right. I mean, yeah, right. Right. No. I'm not calling any pawn shop owner, strip club owners, or bail bondsmen. Like, there's plenty of straight and narrow people that are respectable. Blah, blah, blah. I'm just saying, if you are a con man and you get into businesses like these and deal with maybe sketchier type clientele,
yeah,
and you are nefarious and a con man and willing to bend the rules and break the law and like make as much money as possible, you could thrive and make plenty of money and maybe off color.
I don't think that guy Jeff would be a bail bondsman. I don't think he would work at any business where he actually had to work. What that guy wants is a business where he can set up like a tanning salon where he has a pretty girl that, you know, he puts at the counter, or, you know, a check cashing place where he's got some, maybe not that, but, or like a laundromat where he's got, you know, his machines or whatever. That guy doesn't want to actually do the work to run the business. That guy wants to be the mastermind and run the show and then con other people into giving money for those businesses or live it up while he's got them. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. No, I know what you mean. Yeah.
What's weird to me.
Yeah, like that guy, if he owned a dry cleaning place, that guy's not doing the dry cleaning. He's not running it. He's, he's leveraging them and using them to get into the next deal. You know what I mean?
That's one of my favorite things I've ever seen are the mismatch family business, meaning that you've got one family member that's maybe old school or tried and true, and then you've got one family member that's like the next generation, but they're like... they're maybe a little more ambitious and then have bigger dreams. And case in point, there used to be a sandwich shop.
Or there's a fuck up.
Yeah, it could be a fuck up. Yeah, but there was a sandwich place here in Orlando that you'll remember, Steve, called Vegas. And it was a Cuban. They do Cuban sandwiches. And we went there one time, and it was like right before it closed down. It got bought by Black Bean Deli. It's now the new Black Bean Deli on Mills.
Yeah.
But like there was Vegas, and it was like you saw like the sandwiches and everything being made, and then off to the right hand side there was a tiny little area that had been remodeled, and it was gold, cash for gold. And then you could tell that generationally it was different. And my point in that is I know what you mean. The guy wants the flashy like fun thing to do that doesn't do much, and then the other things in the background with other employees running it that making money, right?
Yeah. I love it when you see family businesses where it's like fourth generation, fifth generation, and they've got the secret recipe, and you know, they take the pride in what they do and they keep it going. I mean, there's like restaurants like that. New Orleans, like Arno's is like that.
Yeah.
Commander's Palace with the Brennan family, that's like that. You see that in those restaurants. I love businesses that do that, but it's interesting to see when you get that mismatch or when the next generation wants to step it up or whatever. I was watching Horrible Bosses last night. I mean, that was the perfect example. The guy that owns the chemical company dies, and Colin Farrell's like a human garbage can that takes over the business.
Yeah, I mean,
God, I hope one of our kids does that to this company. I just hope it. I hope Maisie runs this thing right in the ground.
They're with the wrong leadership, and you get some nepotism going on, and then the father leaves the business to his son, and he had no business running that business. They'll run it to the ground.
We know that firsthand.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Just some of our clients we've seen.
And
nobody currently.
It's bad.
Oh, yeah.
And it's crazy that they don't see that, or that all this, you know. And like going back to the Tiger King and that POS, he's got like, he convinces other rich dudes that are also in like maybe nefarious, like sketchy, or they got money.
They
got
to be sketchy rich.
Yeah. And then but those people,
he's not rich.
It's bizarre that those people give the con men their money because you're like, how do you not know how, like, you don't seem like a gullible person because you seem like you're hardened by, you know, by like your living situation, and how you even made money leads me to believe you're smart enough to not give this guy your money. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. How did you get rich enough? Like, you were smart enough to get rich, but dumb enough to give this fucking scumbag your money. Like, it's bizarre.
I got to tell you, I mean, I've seen a lot of smart people get wrapped up in cons, and you would not believe it because, you know, there's different levels of con men. There's different levels of fraud, right? You know, there's people that operate on a really basic level all the way up to people that that look like they've got it all together, that fit the mold, that can mix in, you know, mix in sophisticated society, and that can make a compelling argument. And what they, but what they all have in common is, you know, one, they're convincing, right? And but the other part is they play on fear and greed normally, but and greed is what they play on the most. And, you know, they present opportunities that are promising, and people get wrapped up in it. And then what happens is typically, you know, they get somebody in, you know, especially a sophisticated one, they get somebody in a little bit, and then once they've got their claws into them, you know, then they can really dig in, and
people see what you did there.
And then they feel trapped.
Steve, I don't know if you're...
Nice job with the claws reference. That's great.
And Daniel, you can weigh in on this too, but anytime...
I'll wait and see what the question is before I want to weigh in.
Well, Steve, tell me if you're like this, but anytime in my life someone is trying to convince me or sell me on something or whatever, that, you know, when they're trying to push hard or like convince me of whatever.
Okay, I got one in my mind.
I'm always like, well, obviously there's something in it for you, right? Like, I'm like, there's no way that you're man. Doing this in a charity aspect or just to help me and only to help me.
We,
or like,
we have a perfect example.
Unselfish.
You and I had a meeting with one of our friends here. I will not say who it is.
Yeah.
And they tried to convince us to get involved in some sort of penny stocks, like, investment scheme. And when we didn't do it, this person got really, really mad. But mad because they were like, I'm trying to help you. I'm a good person. I'm trying to do something for you, and you don't want to take advantage of it. But I realize, and you realize, that, like you're saying, they were going to benefit from this. So, of course, they were upset that we didn't jump into their Ponzi scheme or whatever, because they weren't going to benefit from us as a mark.
Yeah, like, for instance, if I know, or, like, you know, have a hunch, or, like, a, let's say gambling-wise, right? Like,
we come back to that a lot. It's weird.
Well, it's the only thing that I know that I love and know. Yeah. So I look at a game and I'm like, man, this is off. I think that there's an edge here, and I think you could make some money betting on this. And I go tell Daniel, I'm like, hey, if you know, if I were you, I'd throw a couple $100 on this game because I think it's a good
bet. Well,
if you
said that to me, I would trust it.
Well, but I'm like, do whatever you want. I don't care. You know what I'm saying? Like, right. But if I'm like hardly selling you on it, then like, what is it for me to try to get you to do it? I could tell you, but I'm like, hey, do what you want.
I know you're a friend. Anyway, you're averse to the hard sell. You don't like that. I mean, and frankly, the hard sell is kind of an old school thing anyway. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I guess there's a lot of people that do it, but so the perfect example of the highest level of con that there's ever been is Bernie Madoff.
Yeah.
I mean, the people that got wrapped up with him were really sophisticated, smart people. You know, a lot of them were celebrities. You know, they were wealthy people, you know, and then there were a lot of common people and average people that just trusted him with their retirement and their savings. But I mean, like, I think Kevin Bacon and Kira Sedgwick were wrapped up with
him. Yeah, they were.
I think John Malkovich was. I mean, these are, you know, not only are they actors, but they're respected actors for being intelligent. Like, they don't do stupid buffoonery normally. You know, and the thing that he could always deliver, though, was for decades. I mean, for years, he delivered consistent returns that were high. And nobody understood how that he did it. I mean, but they were willing to ride the train. And some people were smart and they pulled their money out, you know, or they pulled their profits out. And with him, they made a lot of money, right? But you know, other people didn't. And they say that what really took him down was the financial crisis. But and if that financial crisis hadn't happened, he might have been able to keep it going because he was such a good con man, so compelling that people wanted to do business with him. And he had a proven track record of you know, all of these people that were respected, that society people, celebrity people that he could point to and go, look, here's my client list.
Right.
I've been working with these people for years. And so, you know, when you think about that, you know, you can understand how somebody like that could be so successful.
Well, you saw that a little bit. I mean,
human garbage can.
What Steven's talking about right now, you saw a little bit and glimmers of that even in Tiger King. You're having certain celebrities. I'm sure you're familiar with this one. I think Tom is. I would imagine you are, Steven. With even Shaquille O'Neal came out and said, I don't know this guy. I went there as a visitor. I wasn't buying cats from him. You know, so you've got all these other celebrities sometimes that now want to distance themselves from it. But if Joe or Doc or, you know, any of those guys can pull these celebrities into.
Cardi B wants to save Joe.
If you pull them all into your web, though, and just have them. Just something as simple as a photo, you can use that as leverage to other people to get money, right? Because at that point, even it doesn't matter what it is, but you're adding credibility to it.
Yeah, you're getting credibility. So, you know, the guys that are more high level con men, you know, they know how to front. You know, they know how to present an image like they've got money, even if they don't. So, you know, they're driving a 911, they're driving a Porsche. You know, they've got the Rolex, they've got all of the markers of that. They can. They know.
Uh-oh, we lost them.
Must not have good internet in that area.
sound compelling. What's that?
No, your audio is cutting out.
Yeah, we're losing you a little bit. You might want to, tell your kids.
Oh, I'm sorry, I'm here.
Tell your kids to turn off the switch. Hey, play some piano for us. Take us out with a song.
Really? All right.
Yeah. He's going to do it.
All right. I'll try.
It's such a thin line between piece of shit con man and legitimate businessman that is manipulative and kind of a con man, but he just stays above the law enough.
You gotta just be right under it.
Yeah, because I know plenty of manipulators and con men that live in our society and are well respected and are rich, and they're similar to this guy. It's just they just stayed above the line enough to not get in trouble or not have a bad reputation. But they're manipulators and they're con men.
Oh, yeah.
It's definitely a skill.
It's a thing.
And if you have it, you have an advantage over someone who is not a manipulator and not a piece of shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's definitely a superpower within the business world to be that.
I kind of wish I had glimmers of it. You know, I guess I'm a decent talker and I can convince people, but I don't, you know, I wouldn't know what, I don't want to be bad. You know, I don't want to cheat people.
I mean, but it's like me. I'm my whole life is making compelling arguments and, you know, and dealing with people and being and trying to be persuasive to, you know, get a good result or to negotiate or whatever, you know, but I've chosen to use my powers for good. And also it has the benefit of not being a criminal or winding up in jail. So, I mean, there's that, too. And that I can sleep at night and look myself in the mirror, you know?
No,
the chat room was very impressed that it took you so long to walk to your piano, which means you have a big house. Tom literally.
No, that was just I was trying not to fall down the stairs with a laptop in my hand.
Tom,
I could lay in bed and twinkle the keys with my toes.
With his toes, yeah. It's very. I mean, but it's weird that you guys put the piano right next to the toilet. It's so odd. What are you gonna play?
I don't know. What do you want me to play?
Anything, man. You're a talented musician. Just
Joe had those tigers. He raised them up for cubs. But then he met Carol. He turned his world upside down. Poor Joe Exotic. Now he's in jail. I'm sorry about the spoilers. But it had to be said.
That was great! Yeah,
impromptu Tiger King song.
That was great. It's time to open. Now, this has been a dream. I didn't know that. I didn't want to bring this up and ruin the surprise of Steven doing something while he's on quarantine or while we're all kind of like on lockdown. But Steven has always wanted to do, and I think it's a great idea, the virtual piano bar.
where we, you know, it doesn't have to be with us, but he could go in the BDM room, throw up the camera, he's at the keys, he's reading the chat, people give him songs.
Yeah, I like that.
Are you guys there?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't want to lose you.
No, you're good.
It'd be cool to do a virtual piano like night. I mean, I guess maybe it's even better on quarantine and just do like a Twitch room and take requests.
So just play us a song, Steve, and then we'll,
we're running out of time, so it'd be nice to go out with a song.
Yeah. Again, One Firm for
Any
Life.
Any requests, any artists you want to hear?
I'm trying to think. Let me see if the chat room, let me see if they say anything. Yeah. Does anybody, somebody said Freebird, but Dan Paul, that's too easy. We got to get, so let's see.
Yeah, tell me, take requests.
How about Norm says some Super Tramp. Oh, that's good.
It's kind of that's a Christmas song. Peanuts. It's kind of like, I think it's how everybody feels right now, right?
Yeah.
Joe Exotic. Christmas time is here. Grandma got Corona and died. Don't worry about Corona anymore. There ain't got a cure, but I'm totally sure that Trump has got the My Pillow guy on here.
While I'm away, push down the demons inside, and it won't be long before you.
Yeah, Kramer.
And I
guess that's why they call it the blues.
Time on my hands, I'll be time spent laughing like children,
living like lovers, rolling like thunder under the covers. And I guess that's why they call it the blues.
Talented motherfucker. He's lost in his music.
What if he saw someone like that creep behind in the window? He's behind you! Is this entertainment now in the post corona future?
If you loved music, you'll love music that doesn't sound as good.
Sound bad?
No, it's just the connection is bad. You sound great, man.
Yeah.
You sound great, but I think it's funny. It's like, if you liked music in high fidelity, you'll love music in no fidelity.
No, not on Skype. Maybe on FaceTime or something, or Zoom.
Do you tell?
Yeah, we could try Zoom. I can work on that.
If I ever do a piano night, don't do it on Skype.
I get enjoyment out of you telling your family. You're like, all right, go to the learning room. Daddy's got to do
a parody song about the Tiger King to Elton John. That's why they call it the blues.
I mean,
that's kind of where we're all at right now. Everybody's a little bit blue. We're all in a little funk. I thought that was topical and appropriate.
That was great. I got to get you a USB mic. Somebody mentioned it in there. We're just going to have to hook one up because that'll help a little bit. So you won't have to.
Yeah, there's probably a way to do that. That would be a smart way to do it. I mean, I've got some stuff here, so We'll have to tweak that.
Well, brother, it's good talking to you, and I'm so glad that you and your family are safe and everybody's all right. And
yeah,
I know
you guys.
I know this wasn't ideal, but I thought it worked out pretty damn good, and
I thought so too.
Really, we missed you.
Just edit that last part out, okay?
Yeah, okay. I actually really liked it, and I sang over some of it too.
And again,
that's good.
If you have a legal issue, one
well,
firm
actually,
for life.
You know what you probably had, actually, is you probably had the bass on the piano over spiking on the mic.
Yeah, well, there's onboard, like, what do you call them? There's, like, gates that'll, you know, that are working. Yeah. You'd have to turn all
clipping.
That. Yeah, you'd have to turn it all off. So, and that's
it was clipping. That makes sense.
And
sorry.
Steve, you set up your law firm so people can talk to you guys virtually, correct?
Yeah, we're doing all our client and consults right now remotely, at least for now. But we're trying to do it so that it's the having an attorney, especially like in a divorce setting, is so personal, or even an injury case is so personal, that it's good to be able to look your lawyer in the eye, you know what I mean, and get a feel for them, because you want to make sure you go with your gut on that. So we're trying to do it by Skype, Facebook, FaceTime, Zoom, you know, giving all the options for people. And then we do phone too. But I think, you know, if it was me and I was going to hire somebody to handle my stuff, I'd want to look them in the eye.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah. No, I agree. And body language is extremely important when it comes to communication. So, yeah, I second that.
All right, Steve. Well, it was good talking to you, dude. Take it easy.
You guys, dude, be safe, okay?
Yeah, you too, man. Anytime. We'll be talking at you, okay, man?
All right, do that. I'll see you.
All right, man. Be good.
Raccoon King is coming to get you.
Yeah, there's our buddy, Steven Kramer. And we hope you enjoyed A Gentleman's Guide. OneFirmForLife.com. That was fun. Mm-hmm. That was different. You know, this is how things are going to be from here on out. In fact, now it's going to be all of us in little pods, and we just, you know, just our faces up there.
Yeah.
And then you'll never, ever know what it feels like to have skin-on-skin Hawaiian justice. Dog the Bounty Hunter is like, he's freaking out, because you can't do skin-on-skin Hawaiian justice virtually.
Yeah.
You know, you got to really put your titties on their titties.
Yeah. Dog's had a rough couple years.
Now he's marrying that other lady, right?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, he's
What's
back
What's her name?
It,
like Matilda Violet Margarita or something like that.
Yeah.
I saw he's on Cameo for $110.
Oh, you can get Dog?
You can get his front teeth only. Steven's calling me. He's like, how was it? I'm still on the show.
Will he tiny chop a carrot with his front teeth? Because I
can ask
for $100.
Hey, Butler, go on Cameo and give Dog the Bounty Hunter $110 to tiny chop a carrot with his front chomps.
All right.
He said, got it.
He's on it, boss.
See, you guys want a cure for corona? Fuck it. There is none. We're giving you Dog the Bounty Hunter eats a carrot with just his front teeth.
All right.
I'll give you $120 if he smokes the carrot like a cigarette. All right, motherfuckers. Yeah. We're out of here. Yeah. We'll see you. Oh, hold on. I'll end with this. I'll really freak out. Depressed emo child. All right, y'all. We will see you. We'll see you.
Yeah.